Hello, and welcome to the University of Georgia Learning with the Dawgs. With the holiday season upon us, we spend a lot of time around the table. So our theme for this session would be holidays round the table. You will find many things you can do with your family, from food to crafts to actually making wreaths. So sit back, relax, and we'll be right back. Hello, and welcome back to Learning with the Dawgs. My name is Rhea Bentley, and I'm the County Extension Director and the Family Consumer Sciences Agent here with the University of Georgia Extension. So it's holiday time, so what are some things that we can make where we can get the family involved? So today, I know you've had Monte Cristos deep fried with powdered sugar and jelly and all those types of things. So today, I'm going to teach you how to do a healthy Monte Cristo, and we're going to use mustard cheese, turkey, and ham. And then we're gonna dip it in eggnog, so it'll be an eggnog Monte Cristo. So let's get started. So first of all, let's make sure we have all of our ingredients. You're gonna use Dijon mustard. You're gonna need some mayonnaise. You're gonna need turkey, mustard cheese, or either Gouda. And then you're gonna need turkey. And then you're gonna need eggnog. And you need bread. So, the first step is to do a tablespoon and a half of mustard and mayonnaise. So let's get that going. And this is just regular Dijon mustard. I got the one with the stone ground. You can get regular or you can get stone ground, it's up to you. And then we're gonna mix this together, like so. So our first step, you're gonna use 9 pieces of bread, but today I'm just gonna use 1 to show you exactly what to do, and then we'll walk through the process. So you start out with your 3 slices of bread, and you put your mustard and mayonnaise mixture on it, on each slice. This is regular white bread. You can use whole wheat if you want. This is white bread made with whole grains. So you just spread it evenly amongst the slices of bread. If you don't have enough, if you want more on your sandwich or less, you can make more, or else you can use less. It's up to you. But for 3 sandwiches, it will take a whole lot more. So I'm gonna use this in here. As you can see, I just used a tablespoon and a half just to make this one. So my next step is to add the cheese, the ham, and the turkey. So we're gonna start with the cheese because you want it closest to the heating element. And so we're gonna put it on the base of this sandwich. This is just mustard cheese I got from the deli. And then we're gonna use, you can use ham that you've cooked, or you can use deli sliced ham. I just did deli sliced ham. And then the same with the turkey, just oven roasted turkey. You can use your leftover turkey from Thanksgiving or from Christmas, it's up to you. So we'll put the turkey on there. I think I put too many pieces. We'll take a piece off. Then we're gonna just lay the bun on top. Then we're gonna start another layer. Then we'll add our turkey. And to make these sandwiches, it takes about 1/2 pound of turkey to do a full recipe. It makes 3 sandwiches, and then we cut them into triangles. Okay, and then on this one, you turn the bread over to the top of it. Let me make sure I put my cheese on there. So what you do next is you're gonna cut off the edges. I'm using a serrated knife, And this is probably the hardest part of making the recipe, trying to make sure you get all the edges off, or what we want to call the crust of the bread. And then you can eat the little ends if you want. There's still meat on them. All right, so that's what our sandwich is gonna look like. Then the next step is we're gonna wrap it in plastic wrap. You wanna wrap it tightly in the plastic wrap. So it's secure, so this will help the sandwich to mold together and gel together well. And plastic wrap, you can always pull it as tight as you want it. So then you're gonna refrigerate this for 30 minutes up to 6 hours. So now let's get moving with cooking. We're gonna refrigerate that one, but I'm gonna go ahead and show you something that I've already prepped up. Alrighty, so let's get some of this cleaned up. Alright, so we're gonna start with, we're gonna use the electric skillet, but you can use a regular skillet from at home. You can just do it on your stove in a frying pan. It calls for 3 tablespoons of butter, so it's about a tablespoon of butter per sandwich. And they have it marked off nicely for you here. So you can just cut that tablespoon. Then we're gonna melt it in the skillet. And I have this skillet on medium. So while that's melting, here are my sandwiches. I have 3 that I've wrapped up. I'm gonna unwrap my first one. If your skillet is large enough where you can do 2, go ahead and do 2, but I'm just gonna do 1 at a time so you can see exactly how it goes. Well, I'll do 2, why not? Because we can do 2 at a time. That saves time. So while that's melting, we're gonna use our eggnog to dip the sandwich in. Usually at Monte Cristo's you use milk. So I'm just using regular eggnog. This is non-alcoholic. You use about 1/2 cup. And you take your sandwich and you dip it in the eggnog, and I'm going to use some tongs to turn it over. So you dip it like so. Want to make sure you get plenty on there. As you can see here, our butter's melting. I'm going to turn it down a little bit so it doesn't burn. So I'm going to take our first sandwich and I'm going to put it over in the butter. So you're going to cook this till both sides are actually brown. It smells really good with that butter and that eggnog. So we're going to take another one and do the same thing. We soaked it in the eggnog. Then we flipped it over to make sure we have the eggnog all within the bread. And then we're going to cook that one. Once you get them in there, you can turn your heat up just a little bit. So while those are cooking, I just want to tell you some of the things you can do with this Monte Cristo. You can use jellied cranberry sauce and dip it in there, but today I'm going to use a cranberry orange relish. You can get that in your stores or you can make it. It's made with cranberries and it's made with orange zest. So it's really tasty, and that's what we're going to use today. So while these are browning, we're gonna go ahead and get our zest going. Excuse me, put our dressing, or our relish, excuse me, into our tray. And this looks delicious. And I know you're wondering, are we gonna eat those whole sandwiches? But what we're going to do is we're gonna cut them into quarters. And then we're gonna sprinkle a little bit of brown sugar on it once we have it ready. So I'm gonna put all these bread pieces in this bowl. So when we take our sandwich out, we can put it here and cut it. And this one's gonna go in the refrigerator. So let's check and see how they're doing. It may take 2 to 3 minutes on each side. It just depends. You wanna make sure, that one's looking good. You wanna make sure that your cheese is melting in the process. And some of you may make your own eggnog at home. You can use that. You can use any kind of cheese you want. I just recommend it using the Munster or either the Gouda. Gives it a good flavor. So these are looking really pretty. You wanna see them cooking. That's them cooking. So we're gonna get this other side cooked well. And while those are cooking, I'm just gonna go ahead and add this last one that I wrapped in plastic wrap. And we can go ahead and get that one and it'll be done. All right, so I'm checking my heat. And these may be a little warm when you take them out, so you can have the kids help you make the sandwiches, but you may not want them working over the heat. This will be something good to have with leftovers or to eat with your family just for dinner. And everybody can help. You can do it around the table, as we say. So let's check these two and see how they're looking. We're gonna cook just a couple more seconds. The cheese is all melted, they look scrumptious. Now the key to this is gonna be cutting them into quarters. So we wanna make sure we get them to cook quite a bit of time so they stay together and everything's melted. So I'm gonna turn my heat up just a little bit. And like I said, you can use an electric skillet, you can use a frying pan, or whatever you choose. If you don't wanna use real butter, I'm using unsalted butter. You can use like, I can't believe it's not butter, or butter with canola oil. You have a lot of options of butter you can use. So I am going to take this first one out, and I'm gonna sit it here on the cutting board. And then I'm gonna check our other one, see how it's looking. It's just about done, so I'm gonna turn it over one more time. And then we have this other one still cooking here because we have the butter in there. So if you use an electric skillet, watch your heat. I have it on like 250, between 250 and 300. So just monitor your heat really well. Warm heat is probably the best. So I'm gonna take this one out. And your sandwich should be kind of crispy. If it's not crispy enough, you can put it back in the skillet. Or you can just like stick it in the oven for a few minutes. So I'm gonna turn this down so I can go over here and we can get this all set up. So we have our little tray here. So we're gonna cut these into fourths. I have a serrated knife. And like I said, this is gonna be the challenge. So we cut that one in half, but I wanna do this one in quarters. So I'm gonna turn the board so it'll be easier for me. And we're gonna do this one in quarters. And this is the best kind of knife to use when you're trying to cut something with bread, a serrated knife. So we just take our sandwich quarters. See, that cheese was real cheesy. And we just add them to our tray here. And you have a meal. Have a good meal. Let me just add one there, and I'm gonna take one of these. And we're gonna add a piece there. We're gonna slide that over. Add another piece here. And there you have it, eggnog Monte Cristo with cranberry and orange relish. So I'm gonna try to let you know how good it tastes. So I'm just gonna take a piece here, dip it into the cranberry relish, and let's see. That is yummy. So try it at home, I'm sure you'll enjoy it. For this recipe and others, give us a call at 706-653-4200. We'll be right back.
Renew your vehicle registration and sticker without a trip to the county tag office. With convenient grocery store locations, Georgia MV Express kiosks let you scan, pay, print, and walk away with your renewed tag today. For more information and to find your kiosk, visit gamvexpress.com.
Welcome back with Learning with the Dawgs. My name is Ashley Day. I'm the 4-H agent for Columbus, Muskogee, and Chattahoochee County. And one of my favorite holiday traditions is meeting with friends and family around the table. And one of the easiest and simplest ways to include everyone of all ages around the table and prepare for meals is setting the table. And there's actually a correct way to do this, and we're gonna go through the steps today. So we will first start by making sure that our preparation area is clean. We can even put down a placemat if you would like. If we have a charger, we put this down there, and a charger is just a larger plate to help center everything. And then we would start with our dinner plate, and we put it in the center of our placemat or on top of our charger. And if we have a salad plate or soup bowl, we would then place this plate or this bowl on top of the dinner plate. And so we have left and we have our right. And a lot of people will become confused of where we put our forks, where do we put our spoons, where do we put our knives. And one tip that I use is left has four letters and so does fork. So on our left, we're gonna put our fork down. And then our right has five letters, and that's where we're gonna put our knife and our spoon. And both of those have five letters too. Make sure that you place the knife closest to the plate with the blade faces inward. And then the spoon goes right next to it. And then at the top of the plate is where we are going to put our drinks and our bread if we have some where we put our bread plate. And another trick is by making the letters B and D with our hands like this. And on our left is our hands make the letter B, and this is where we're gonna put our bread on the left. And then our right hand makes the word letter D, and that's where we're gonna put our drinks right up here. Also, while we're eating, this is a good time to go over some etiquette as we are eating with friends and family and we don't want to offend anyone. So making sure that we chew with our mouth closed, that we don't talk with food in our mouth, placing our napkin in our lap when we're eating, passing food items to our right, and passing the salt and pepper together. And there's many others that you can look up and kind of touch up as we meet with each other. We hope that you have a great holiday, and we hope to see you next time with Learning with the Dawgs.
Hi, I'm Sharnay Ware, Executive Director here at Keep Columbus Beautiful. Columbus, we've got a problem with litter. Illegal dumping and litter causes an increase in blight and a decrease in property values. Litter can be an eyesore and aid in crime, and not to mention, it's illegal. Why should you care about litter? Let's count the ways. More than $10 million in labor are spent picking up trash citizens throw on the grounds of our beautiful state of Georgia. Studies show that 80% of that trash is generated on lands and ends up in our waterways, which threatens our marine life. So please, do the right thing, Columbus. Do not litter, or you will pay the price. How you can help? You can report any offense of littering to 311 by providing their tag number, a vehicle description, and the location where you saw the litter take place. So, Columbus, let's do our part and help keep Columbus beautiful.
Welcome back to Learning with the Dawgs. My name is Ashley Brantley, and I am the UGA Extension Agriculture and Natural Resources Agent here in Muskogee County. And today I wanted to give you a few tips on how to care for your holiday plants, as these really offer a festive touch this time of year. And for many of us, they're really an important tradition as well. And so my first tip for you today is, when possible, try to choose a healthy plant. And by healthy plant, I just mean one that has lush green foliage from top to bottom and is somewhat symmetrical all the way around. Now, when you are purchasing your plants, if possible, try to stay away from those that have yellowing leaves. These will unfortunately not last long once you get them home. Now, while you're at the store picking out plants, you'll want to look for certain characteristics. And the first one is for poinsettias. So other than that dark green lush foliage, you will also want to look for fully colored bracts or flowers. And for our other flowering holiday plants, such as holiday cactus, that you look for ones that have lots of unopened flower buds, as these will offer you plenty of beautiful blooms once you get them home. Now, once you're at home, my other tip for the day is to make sure that you're putting them in a warm location where the air temperature is somewhere around 60 to 75 degrees Fahrenheit, and where they will get some bright but indirect light. So of course you want to stay away from areas that are somewhat drafty, like around vents or doors. And then my last tip for you, and the most important tip, is to make sure that you are checking your holiday plants regularly for their water needs. Most of our holiday plants really like a moist soil, so one that's not too wet or too dry. And the easiest way to check is to really just touch the soil surface. If it feels dry to the touch, then they need water. If not, wait another day or two and then check again. And when you're watering your plants, you want to keep in mind most of these come in some kind of decorative, colorful floral or other decorations with a pot inside of a pot. And so you just want to make sure that you're removing these when you water, because you want to make sure that you're giving your plants enough water. The water is draining out the drainage holes in the bottom, and you don't really want anything to impede that. And so for a successful holiday season, you really want to make sure that you're following these simple tips. So one, start out with a healthy plant. Two, make sure it's in a warm location where it receives plenty of sunlight. And then three, make sure that you're checking it regularly for water needs. So for more information on how to care for your holiday plants, you can either check out the UGA Extension webpage, where you can find our publication on caring for holiday and gift plants, or you can contact our office directly at 706-653-4200. I wish everyone a happy holidays, and please stay tuned for more Learning with the Dawgs.
Renew your vehicle registration and sticker without a trip to the county tag office. With convenient grocery store locations, Georgia MV Express kiosks let you scan, pay, print, and walk away with your renewed tag today. For more information and to find your kiosk, visit gamvexpress.com.
And welcome back. I'm Tammy Keith.
And I'm Valencia.
We work with our parenting programs, and we work with young children, and so we want to talk a little bit about how to incorporate young children into the holiday activities, especially when it regards the kitchen and around preparing food for family and friends. So we're going to talk a little bit about that today. The first thing that we want to remind you is that anytime you're handling food, especially with young children, is getting them in the habit of washing their hands first.
And often, if need be. Also working in smaller quantities of things for children in case there is a mishap, so you're not spilling a lot of things. Even if you have to refill bowls for them to continue with an activity, starting with smaller quantities. So one of the things we want to talk about is things that children can do ahead of time. So as we're preparing for the holiday event where you may have family and friends, what are some things children can do in the days prior to get everything ready so that they're not necessarily in the middle of things on that day when you're cooking and the stove is hot and things like that? So we do have some safety issues that we're going to remind you about as we move forward. So one of the things that children can do naturally is helping get foods prepared. We know that there are some kid-friendly tasks that they can do and that they learn a lot from helping in the kitchen.
Also, I have some benefits of cooking with children. So first, the great benefit is family time, and this creates a bond, a time to create memories and learn. Also, math practice. It offers practice on basic math skills like counting and adding ingredients. Also gives the confidence. Confidence boosts, boosts your confidence from learning new techniques and giving you a chance to motivate them. Exposure to new food choices. This broadens the exposure to different flavors and textures, especially for picky eaters. Life skills. It teaches the basic skills that will follow them into their adulthood. And lastly, better eating habits for the foods that you choose. So choices encourages nutritious eating habits and prevents obesity, and thanks to growth of food knowledge.
And so there are a few things that we can allow kids to do in the kitchen that are really kid-friendly. One is if you're preparing vegetables, allowing them to wash them ahead of time, having a safe way for them to access the water and scrub the fruit, whether it be potatoes, sweet potatoes, any of those fruits that are vegetables that could need washing. One of the great things that children can also do is, as they're learning things, assisting you, pouring things in as you're adding ingredients, helping to measure so that they get an understanding of what size is a half a cup compared to a cup. And so they're learning some basic math. They can definitely help by sprinkling. So if you have done, made cakes or cupcakes or deviled eggs where they can sprinkle toppings on the top, that's a great task, especially for smaller children. And then plating, being able to help plate the food or place it on a serving tray. These are ways that they can help where they're not directly in the food making. Also rolling out dough or rolling and crushing items for a mixture. We just want to make sure we encourage them that if you are rolling dough, not to eat it if it's raw and it's got eggs in it, because that could have some health issues. And then mixing things. So teaching them how to mix and to mix slowly and thoroughly, whether it be dry ingredients or even wet ingredients. So those are some of the things that children are, that's kind of kid friendly, things that they can do without it really messing anything up. So, because we want our holiday to go well, we don't want any upset if something don't come out right. So we want to look at some simple things that kids can do. One of the most important things is making sure you have kid-sized utensils and kid-sized equipment. So you'll notice that we've got a lot of our things here in small bowls. We're working in small amounts. We have small-sized scoops, so it makes it a little bit easier to fit their hands, small spoons. We're working mostly with plastic, so we don't have to worry about anything that would be breakable. And then even as we're looking at bowls, choosing things that are a little bit smaller for them so that they can handle it and move it around without spilling or sloshing. Also, if they're going to be pouring, be sure to make sure it's in something a little smaller, like a measuring cup, even if we don't need to measure, but it allows it to be a smaller amount for me to pour so it's not as sloshy and I don't make as big of a mess. So one of the things that kids can make ahead, we've got a trail mix that we're going to do, and we call it a s'mores trail mix. It's kind of a deconstructed s'mores. So we have Teddy Grahams that stand in for our graham crackers. We have miniature marshmallows, and we have the miniature chocolate chips. So it gives us a small amount of those things. So allowing children to kind of scoop and create this and store it as other relatives come in or other children come in, and they can share that. You can use small snack size bags or small plastic containers that you can get at your local dollar store really inexpensively, and then they can be reused. So having directions about how many scoops of Teddy Graham, so if we say we want 2 scoops of these in there for every bowl or every bag and allowing them to scoop that in, maybe 1 scoop of marshmallows in every bowl, and then maybe 1 scoop of chocolate chips. So we've got a great little snack ready to go. They can make them ahead of time, several days ahead. And that can be stored so that as relatives arrive, especially if there's a lot of young children, it makes a quick, fun snack. You'll notice that we did choose a smaller spoon for the chocolate chips, so we didn't get quite as many of those in there, so that we can make it more kid-friendly and not overdose on the too much of the sweet stuff. You can alter any of these kind of ingredients if it doesn't fit your family. If you have individuals that are food sensitive, you can alter this to use cookies that are grain-free. You could alter it to use dried fruit in place of marshmallows or chocolate. If you have older kids, you can replace it with M&Ms, things like that. That's more pertinent to them. So that's one thing that they can do well ahead of time. Another thing, if you're doing a veggie plate, and let's say you're gonna do dip, oftentimes when we do a dip, it may include just 2 ingredients. It may include sour cream or yogurt, and it may include 1 packet of ingredients. So this is a very simple thing that children can do, being able to put it in a bowl. You notice I have a good sized bowl for this. Well, we wanna make sure that they have room to stir without sloshing it out, because they may be just learning how to do that. So allowing them to have a bowl, a short sized spoon that they can use that will allow them to mix and stir easily is really important for young children, so that they don't become frustrated and that they're able to adequately do what you're asking them to do.
And so I also have a recipe that I would like to share, and this could be during the time or breakfast for the family before the big dinner, or even time where your children want to snack while you're cooking. So I want to share with you a breakfast parfait, and I have here some yogurt, and I'll go ahead and open it up. I have some Teddy Grahams here, and then some cereal, and also the blueberries. And also you can see that we have a small strainer, so when you want to wash those fruits, as Miss Tammy mentioned, you could use it as with a kid size strainer. Also, I have my banana, and I have my rolling pin, so when I get ready to crush up the graham crackers. So I'm going to move this out the way. And what I'll do is go ahead and begin to show you how you could support your children, your kiddos, by having them scoop. And what they're doing, they're using their fine motor skills as they scoop and place inside of the cup here. Get that. Set that off to the side, and you could layer it however you feel, or however the kid chooses to layer it. So I will go ahead and use my Teddy Grahams and take a few, and I can crush these by using my kid-size rolling pin.
Yep. Okay.
Oh, well, there we go. And I'll probably take maybe a few. And what your children are doing are learning like how to crush and making different textures with the Teddy Grahams. And if you just don't necessarily have a rolling pin for your kiddos, you can always use a nice can and do it the same way. And so as you see, I have crushed a couple of Teddy Grahams. And I will place that, and the children will have fun with sprinkling it here. I'm just gonna sprinkle a couple more. And you can also use dry cereal too. And once again, that scooping method that your children are learning or using will also can be here.
And we
we work a lot with young children, so these are skills that they're learning and emerging. But if you have school-age children, these are skills that they also need to keep reinforcing, and this is a great way to do that.
Yes. Also, I have my banana. So you can also teach your child how to peel the banana, and they will enjoy seeing those layers just come off. And also, you will be teaching your children how to cut. So they're building that skill as well. So I'm just gonna cut a few.
And again, if you have school-aged children, they may be able to kind of move from the plastic fork to the butter knife, something that's a little bit heavier and a little bit more difficult for young children to use. But we love the plastic plastic knives for the young children.
For their babies, yes. So I've layered it in that. I'll also add another scoop of yogurt. And once again, you can do this however you feel, or the kiddos can.
And then you notice we're using a small thing of yogurt.
Yes.
So, you know, kind of going back to using the small quantities at a time. And if you do buy yogurt in a large container, I would suggest you put it in a little bit smaller bowl for them to scoop from, so that if I get dirty little hands in there, it's not the whole container that my hands are in.
Exactly. So also you have your fruit, and I have this can of peaches. So it's a fruit of your choice. We're just choosing blueberries today. And they will take their little fingers and they will place them and layer them.
And if you're doing this as a parent-child or a grandparent-child activity, you can even have them count how many they put on there.
Mm-hmm. So, counting is a fun game and activity to do as well. All right, so as you see, I have built my layer of my parfait, and they will enjoy tasting, making it, and creating it.
There are a lot of other options that, parfaits are so easy. We love them around here. We do them in every which way. But there are a lot of other options that you can put in for your parfaits as well.
Yes, so you can also do applesauce. If you don't want to use yogurt, pudding, that's also vanilla, and chocolate. Those are also some other alternatives or options that you can use. Whatever that your child feels appropriate and happy with doing.
So one of the things when we talk about these types of activities, these are activities that can actually be done at the tabletop. They don't have to be in the kitchen.
Right.
Because on that day, things get a little crowded in there, things get busy, things get hot. And so we want to encourage you to make sure that you create a safe zone around your oven or stove, which is about 3 feet around that, to make it a no-kid zone. Also to turn the pot handles away from the front. To give it a little bit more security. And then also, while you're busy in there, hopefully your child is busy with relatives, and one way that they can bond and interact is by choosing books that kind of go along with the season. So some of the books we have are Feast for 10, which is a great book. It talks about a family going shopping together, cooking together, then eating together. And it's children of all ages, and it's a counting book, so it counts up to 10 and down again, so it's a great story, one of my favorites. Also, we have a book about families, and this book is just about all kinds of families. It talks about some families live close, some families live far away, so it's a great book for the holidays. We also have one of Llama Llama and Gives Thanks, and so it talks about all the things he's thankful for, like his family and being able to eat and enjoy being with them. So we definitely want to make sure that we incorporate literature into this and boost those literacy skills. When kids are in the kitchen, all the different things that you, the different vocabulary words that you add for them also increases their literacy. When you're talking about slicing something or cutting something or scooping something, these are all words that children will be able to use in a context, and they really can see a concrete action for that word. So it's a great way to build literacy as well.
Yeah.
So if you want more information about some of our recipes or more ideas to share with your children, please contact our office and ask to speak to Laurel Coakland, our First Steps coordinator, who can get you to us as well to give you more questions about child development and things that you can do with your children. Our number is 706-653-4200. Thank you.